Every patch sees many new crazy builds emerge, and our analysts have been hard at work digging those up for you guys so you can be the first to abuse them before anyone else. Welcome back to another Skill Cap video, and in this one, we'll be breaking down 10 of the most OP new Korean builds in patch 11.5. Every build we feature is either being played by Korean pros or has a very high win rate in solo queue, so you can be sure each build is legit. Are there any new builds that you guys have been playing that you think we missed? Be sure to share them with us down in the comments below. And so you don't miss out on any of our meta content again, hit that subscribe button and turn on notifications so you can get ahead of everyone else. Without taking up any more time, let's get right into it. Back in our 11.4 edition of this video, we covered the Essence Reaver Fiora build, which since then has now become her number one build in solo queue. Another top laner we haven't mentioned yet that you need to be building ER on is Riven. This build has started popping up a lot more this patch, and we expect it to rise even further for 11.5. Koreans are loving Gore Drinker into Essence Reaver and then Sterix for the complete build. Our analysts believe that Black Cleaver will also slot in really nicely third after its buffs this patch. The win rate spread between ER, Cleaver, and Ravenous as a second item on Riven is really insane. Essence Reaver wins 2% more than Ravenous and 7% more than Black Cleaver. This is pretty nuts considering Riven doesn't even benefit from the mana back passive that Essence provides. It just goes to show how great of an item ER really is. The strength of the build lies in the amount of versatility it provides. With Gore Drinker, you have a nice bit of tankiness, and then Essence provides a nice pop of burst for the perfect mix. Since Riven has relatively short cooldowns on all her abilities and wants to weave in autos to benefit from her passive, the Spellblade proc from ER is really amazing for her. Look to abuse this setup while you can, as we wouldn't be surprised to see Reaver nerfed in the coming patches. It feels like every single patch as of recent, we have a new champion dominating with Stridebreaker, and that's no different in 11.5. Renekton is the new champ on the block abusing the item, and even with the adjustments to Stride this patch, our analysts still believe it will remain extremely strong. A few Korean pros abusing this one include Thal and Roach, while even Western Renektons like Wonder are running it as well. Even though the damage and slow on Stride are being lowered slightly, the dash range is being increased, which you could argue is a net positive change for someone like Renekton. Dash range going from 200 up to 300 will give Renekton such insane pick range and allow him to effortlessly find those stuns with his W. We've seen Prowler's Claw become more popular on Renekton too, but leaves him way more squishy and vulnerable, so Stridebreaker has been pulling through as the more consistent purchase. Ever since the Gore Drinker nerfs, it's just a little underwhelming on a majority of bruiser picks, and players are finally realizing the strength that Stride offers. Even stat-wise, Stridebreaker wins 3% more than Gore Drinker, which just backs up how good the item really is. For the complete setup, run Stridebreaker into Sterix and then Black Cleaver or Guardian Angel third. If you guys watched our Everfrost video, then you'd know of 12 different champs who are now super strong with the item. However, one we didn't mention is Gragas. We really didn't expect or even think to look at Everfrost on Gragas, but it makes so much sense. Thal and Noguri are two Korean notables enjoying the build along with many others. As Gragas' Q mana cost has been increased in 11.5, building Everfrost is even more beneficial since you'll have all that mana as opposed to building something like Night Harvester, which provides none. One issue with Gragas' engage is that after you connect with E and throw ult to knock the enemy back towards you, sometimes they're able to flash away before your ult goes off. Everfrost completely gets rid of that counterplay. When you slam into the enemy with E, use Everfrost active immediately. Throw down ult, and there's no way the enemy can avoid being knocked back into your team. Everfrost just makes Gragas' pick power so much more reliable and way easier to execute. Noguri has been following up the Everfrost rush with a Cosmic Drive second, and we've seen this core setup become so good now on countless number of champs. Round things out with Zhonya's third, and you're all set. Alright, this next build is not really being played by a Korean pro, but it's interesting and we wanted to make sure you guys are aware of it. Instead of making a whole separate video, we just kinda decided to include it here. Selfmade, the jungler for Fnatic, has been hard spamming Talon jungle in solo queue and has actually been winning a ton with it. His match history is literally 90% Talon for the past week now. Talon was just directly buffed in 11.4, which is likely the main reason to why more people are picking it up. If you have a look at the EU West ladder, rank 17 is a Talon jungle main with an insane 70% win rate, so this is definitely a contributing factor as well. Way back in 10.4, Talon got a buff to his passive bleed damage against monsters, so this gave him some initial viability as a jungler. With the AoE damage from W and this extra passive bleed damage to monsters, his clear isn't as bad as you may expect. Hard farming isn't at all how you want to play him though. The setup consists of running Ignite with Smite as your summoner spells. We all know Talon has ridiculous early game damage, so by running Ignite, you can play super aggro and look for invades while opting for a heavy gank style. Once you hit level 3, you've got the safety net from E to hop over walls, so it's not as necessary to take Flash for jungle Talon in specific. The full build is Prowler's Claw with Lucidity Boots, a Serpent's Fang or Ghostblade second, and then Edge of Night third. You want to take Conqueror as your keystone with Domination secondary, running Sudden Impact and Ravenous Hunter. Start Q level 1, take W level 2, E level 3, and then proceed to max W first, Q second, and E last. Korean jungler Mujin has been playing a bruiser style on his Graves. The build is really unique with a Stridebreaker rush into Edge of Night 2nd and Black Cleaver 3rd. When you think about it, Stridebreaker has some really good use cases for Graves. Due to Graves' passive, the closer you are to the opponent, the more damage you'll deal. Stridebreaker lets you play way more aggro due to the tankiness it provides, and also gives amazing sticking power. The extra dash and slow from Stride allows you to stay right up next to the opponent and deal maximum damage. Roll with Phase Rush as your keystone, and there's no way the enemy is escaping once you're in range. A really undervalued aspect of Stridebreaker is that it grants 30 move speed for 2 seconds when dealing physical damage, so this just adds another layer to your sticking strength. There are so many different variations of Graves builds going around at the moment, so be sure to give this one a shot and see if you enjoy it. Twisted Fate is another champion among many who is performing exceptionally well with Everfrost Rush. Almost every single pro who's playing TF in solo queue has been abusing Everfrost. The best use of the Everfrost active on TF is to extend his initial gold card CC. You want to hit the gold card first, and then while the enemy is stunned, you follow with the guaranteed route from Everfrost to lock them down for a maximum duration of 2.5 to 3.5 seconds, depending on your points in W. Everfrost really just makes Twisted Fate's lockdown insanely broken, and allows him to capitalize on pick plays way more consistently. The mana is also a really nice benefit from the item, as the more popular Rocket Belt provides none. Everfrost is winning about 3% more than Rocket Belt in solo queue, with well over 30,000 games of sample size, so the build is without a doubt very strong. Lichbane will be slotted in as your second item and then pick up Rapid Fire Cannon third. Once you complete Fire Cannon, the pick potential just isn't even fair, as you'll have the longer range on gold card and also be able to extend that CC with Everfrost. Diving into a few ADC builds now, we first have a pretty wild one for Ezreal. Essence Reaver into Manimmune and Ravenous Hydra is the setup, and if you're wondering what's so unique about this, it's that you completely skip building any mythic item. Well-known Korean ADCs like Viper, Ruler, and Deft have all been loving this new setup. Duskblade is bought about 70% of the time in solo queue, second item on Ezreal, however, almost every single pro has been avoiding it. Sure, the 5 ability haste from the mythic bonus on Duskblade is nice, but having ER and Manimmune as your 2 item spike is so much better. Since Manimmune and Essence are both 2900 gold, you're able to hit a really satisfying mid-game spike a little sooner than your crit marksman. The win rate difference between the two builds back everything up as well. ER, Manimmune, and Ravenous win 2% more than ER, Duskblade, and Ravenous. Viper's the lone ADC we'd noticed that's actually built a mythic on his Ez, and it was Frostfire Gauntlet 3rd instead of Ravenous Hydra. You're going to have infinite mana with that setup, along with great added tankiness. In games where the enemy team has heavy burst or lots of dive threat, then opting for Frostfire instead of Ravenous can be a great option. All in all, stop building a mythic first or second on Ezreal, and if you do purchase one third, grab the Gauntlet. Another ADC doing very well with skipping a mythic as their starting item is Ashe. Essence Reaver is just so strong at the moment, to the point where it's performing best as a rush item on so many different picks. Ezreal and Fiora are the two it's been popularized the most on, and players have still yet to realize its true strength on Ashe. ER is just perfect for the champion, because Ashe does tend to run into some mana issues and loves the extra ability haste. The shorter your ult cooldown is, the more plays you can make, and the harder you can snowball early on, which is what Essence Reaver helps with. The short cooldown on Ashe's W also gives her very high value from the Spellblade passive on ER, allowing her to burst for a surprising amount. Essence Reaver Rush on Ashe is winning about 2% more than any of the mythic ADC items. Now, unlike Ezreal, you don't want to completely skip out on building a mythic entirely. Shield Bow, Kraken, and Gale Force all have their place as a second item on Ashe. It really just depends on what you think is best for the game. Round your core build out with an Infinity Edge third. Support players are still heavily sleeping on Chemtech Putrefier as a second or third pickup. By building this item on your Enchanter supports, it allows your ADC to completely bypass building an Executioner's Calling. This saves your ADC 800 gold and allows them to hit their mid-game spike way sooner. If you're unaware, Putrefier now gives your teammates Grievous Wounds on their next attack after you shield or heal them. It's a great pickup on any Enchanter support, but even more of a must-buy on champs like Karma, Seraphine, and Soraka. For example, Karma using a Mantra E in a team fight with Putrefire will give her whole team Grievous Wounds and ensure that the target you're going on will have their healing reduced without question. Now, we're saying the item is highly undervalued, which is true, but at the same time, don't fall into the trap of building it when it's not necessary. If the enemy team doesn't have a considerable amount of healing, then building a Staff or Ardent will be the more optimal pickups. It's just in those situations where the enemy comp consists of two or more heavy healing champs where you'd be trolling if you didn't pick Putrefire up for the mid game. It's all about weighing things out in champion select, thinking about how much healing the enemy comp actually has, and then making the call as to whether Chemtech is an optimal buy for that game. And then the final setup we have for you guys is an interesting one that Korean pro Kellen has been running on his Thresh. Kellen is currently ranked 3 on the Korean solo queue ladder with over 1400 LP. Predator as the keystone with Moby's rush into Deadman's plate is the build. What can we say? If you guys want to play NASCAR Thresh, it doesn't get much better than this. This seems to be a matchup-specific page, as Kellen's running it every single game when up against a Seraphine. Seraphine's a really annoying matchup, so by running Predator, it gives you greater windows of opportunity to look for roam plays and make an impact on the rest of the map. If you're not able to do anything in lane, then using this roam-heavy setup will still allow you to be of use to your team. Although the sample size is quite low in solo queue, with over 8,000 Predator Thresh games, players are winning 52% of the time, compared to Aftershock at 50 and Guardian at 52. In games where you're in easier matchups or don't think you'll be able to achieve much in lane, Predator definitely has great viability to it, and Kellen has been one of the first pros to really adopt this strategy. There's little counterplay to a Thresh running at you with Predator popped and Moby boots, so the likelihood of pulling off successful roam plays is very high. At the same time though, when playing against a very aggressive enemy bot lane with hard engage, taking Guardian or Aftershock is still the way to go, which is what Kellen does. Let's run you down with the complete setup here. Take Predator with Cheap Shot, Zombie Ward, and Relentless Hunter. For secondary runes, roll with Font of Life and Second Wind from the Resolve Tree. The build is rushing Moby's as quick as possible into Deadman's Plate and then Mikhail's Blessing. Alright, so there you have it, 10 new Korean builds that you should be looking to abuse before they catch fire and begin taking over. If you enjoyed this meta content, then don't forget to subscribe if you haven't already, as we're working hard to bring you guys the best new trends before anyone else. Thank you so much for watching, good luck with all these new builds, and we hope to see you back soon.